So this is the section in which Krishna has gone out with his cowherd friends out into the forest. In fact, this is the first demon, Aghasura, is the first demon that Krishna kills outdoors. When the children are very small, they are taken care of by their parents and they can't even go out alone. It's too risky and they are not mature enough. So, Putana, Trunavar, Shaktasur, the three demons whom Krishna has killed till now, they came into the house of Krishna, or into the courtyard at least. Putana came right into the house. Shaktasur was a cart outside his house. And when Trunavar came, Yashodamai was sitting in the courtyard outside her house. But now Krishna has started growing up and Krishna has been entrusted the care of the cows. So he has started going outside now. Oh, just before this, the 12th chapter, just before this, the Damodar Leela has happened. And Krishna has delivered the Nalakur and Manigriv, the twin devatas who had become the giant trees. So when Krishna ventures out with his friends, this pastime just comes before the pastime of the well-known Brahma Vimohan Leela, where Lord Brahma tries to test Krishna and he is outwitted by Krishna completely. So in this particular narrative, Krishna goes out into the forest with his friends to herd the cows. The bigger cows are herded by the cowherd men. And Krishna is a cowherd boy. So we could say he's more precisely a calf herd boy. He's taking care of the cows, small cows, smaller baby cows or small cows. And while he is going out, he also has a jolly good time playing around in the forest. Vrindavan forest is elaborately described in books such as Anandavan Champu by Kavi Karnapur and Gopal Champu by Jiva Goswami. And there they describe the forest is free from all dangers. That actually there is absolutely no predatory animals over there. That everything in Vrindavan is meant for enhancing the pleasure of Krishna, for enhancing the reciprocation of love between Krishna and his devotees. And with that purpose in mind, the forest of Vrindavan provides Krishna all comforts, all facilities for enjoyment, excitement and exploration. But even in the best of places, bad things do happen. And especially when Krishna is here in the material world, then there are demons who come in and disrupt things. So Srila Prabhupada explained that in the spiritual world there are no demons, but there are rumors of demons. Because the rumors enhance the flavor. There is fear, there is suspense, there is sometimes horror, and all that intensifies devotion. The demons themselves have no entry into the spiritual world. But when Krishna manifests in the material world, there is a curious, mysterious interplay between the material and the spiritual when the supreme spiritual reality descends to this world. At that time, from the spiritual world, when the Supreme Lord descends, he himself is spiritual. Many of his intimate associates are spiritual. And he spiritualizes the people around him. But not all people are spiritualizable. Some people have materialistic consciousness, and because of their consciousness, they stay materialistic. Just like in the Mahabharata, Krishna came personally to Duryodhan, and Krishna even demonstrated his Vishwarupa, his universal form. And yet, the demon that Duryodhan was, he was unfazed. He was not transformed at all. So such demoniac people are also there throughout history, and in fact a significant number of people in the soul, number of souls in the material world tend to be demoniac. So some demoniac souls come to Vrindavan also. Now Kamsa is the source who is sending all these demons, and when Kamsa sends these demons, his apprehension is that what will happen if these demons, that he wants Krishna to be killed by these demons. But at the same time, he has had three of his most powerful demons killed by Krishna. Now for Kamsa, it was shocking. If you have some kind of mafia lord, mafia don, and that he has got some powerful hitmen who go and eliminate people. And he sends the hitman for an ordinary hit job. Just like a yellow, finish off a child. And then mysteriously, that hitman ends dead. Of course, Putana was not a hitman. She was a hit woman, you could say. But either way, they all end up dead. So he's shocked. How can such a thing happen? Oh, who is this? Now, Kamsa does not know for sure that Krishna is the son of Devaki. That Krishna is going to be his nemesis. But still he recognizes that Krishna must be someone powerful. Otherwise, how in the wide world could he have caused the death of three of his powerful demons? So therefore, when the other demons go in, they think that we will try to catch Krishna on neutral territory. If a sports match is there, if there's between two matches, then a home ground advantage is there sometimes for the team that is playing. So Vrindavan, they think, is Krishna's home, but he's in the forest, then he's a neutral ground, we'll catch him there. And many of the demons who come in Krishna Leela, they try to conceal their demoniac nature by coming in particular forms. So because we, for example, know of Aghasur primarily in the form of a snake that he has come. That's why we often call him also as snake demon. But Aghasur was a demon in his own right, and demons also have their forms. But they take particular forms for particular purposes. So the body is like a dress, as we know from the Bhagavad Gita. Vasamsi jirnani yatha vihaya, navani grahnati naro parani, yatha sharirani vihaya jirnani, anyani sanyati navani dehi. In 2.21, the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, when the body gets worn out, then the soul gets a new body. So the body is like a dress which the soul gets by one's own karma. Now some souls can have a special karma by which they can change their body temporarily even within a particular lifespan. That means that even while they are going through one life, normally we change our body in a dramatic sense. The body is constantly changing at every moment. But in a dramatic sense, the body changes at the point of death and rebirth. But some souls can assume some other body temporarily. Now we have fancy dress competitions. Recently there was Halloween, where people dress in all kinds of peculiar ways. So here, an external add-on is done. They acquire a costume by putting on some makeup, putting on some dresses, and they try to change their appearance. But when the demons want to change themselves, it's not that they put on something. It's not that there's a Aghasura is a demon and it's put on a snake dress on top of that. Sometimes when we have dramas or when we perform a Krishna Leela in our temples, then some people may just put on the snake skin or something like that to look like a snake demon. But in the case of demons like this, they actually internally, by their mystic powers, they manifest a form like this. And by manifesting such a form, they attract people, they captivate people. And once they captivate people, then whatever ulterior motive they want to fulfill, they try to fulfill. So, normally, when do we conceal ourselves? That is usually when we don't want to be detected. So, the demons, in a sense, they have no reason to conceal themselves because Krishna, because they are very powerful and Krishna is just a small child. If there is some remote, forsaken part of the world where there is not much rule of the law, and then some people want to go and attack over there, they may not even conceal themselves. They might just sneak in. They might charge in and destroy everything and go away. But say some terrorists want to come into some high security building, then they will try to disguise themselves. They want to sneak in. They don't want to be detected till the point when they actually do their work. When they have to do their work, at that time they had to bring out their cover. So similarly, the demons, they are very powerful, but because there's a track record where Krishna in the past has killed several demons, three of them at least. So at least I say, because the Bhagavatam does not necessarily give a complete record of all the pastimes that Krishna has performed. So Krishna may have killed some other demons also that we do not know about in the Bhagavatam that we have. In the acharyas described that the Bhagavatam in the heavenly planets is much, much bigger than the Bhagavatam that we have over here. So, but Krishna has killed several demons till now. So that's why when Aghasura comes along, he does not charge into Vrindavan. He sneaks in and tries to mix with the surroundings. So one way of mixing with the surroundings in the forest is to be like an animal. So he becomes, he takes the form of a snake. And as a snake, the word snake is very closely, it sounds also like the word sneak. Somebody sneaks into a place. And they quietly come in without being noticed. So snakes, if you're not looking at the ground, they can just sneak in somewhere. So of course, Aghasura, when he comes, he has two purposes. First is that he doesn't want to be detected. That's why he comes in a snake. But he knows that he can't hide. Eventually he has to catch Krishna. So he also assumes a form that is huge. So that if he is seen, whoever sees him will become paralyzed, will become stunned, will become both shocked and intrigued. And that is the very reaction that he expects, is what the reaction he gets from the cowherd boys. The cowherd boys see him, and they've never seen anything like this in the wilderness. The previous verses over here have described his giant form. You know, he has huge teeth protruding from his mouth, and it seems like his jaws, which are opened, they are going almost up to the sky. Huge, and his body seems to be so long. So he is a python. Now, snakes normally bite, and that's how they attack and kill. But pythons are different kinds of snakes. They are part of the broad reptile family, similar nature. But pythons, they don't just bite, they swallow. And normally when a person is bitten with a snake, they just die because of the poison. But at least the body remains. But when the python eats, the python is basically, the body itself disappears, the body is swallowed. So it's scary. Now, when people go out into the jungles or wherever they go for trekking or adventure sports or exploring, whatever, at that time, to be killed by an animal is fearsome. It's always fearful to die. To be killed by a snake is fearful. But even in death, we are actually attached to our body. So thought that our body itself will not exist. That means nobody will be able to perform last rites, whether it is burial in the Abrahamic tradition or there is cremation in the Vedic tradition, whatever it is. So the idea that the body at least should be given, you could say, a cultured send-off. The soul has already gone off. But the body, when in a cultured way it is done with it, then that is a proper way to send the soul off respectfully. So traditionally, even when people would be killed in the war, that would be in a war, there is no time to do the last rites of people. But after the war gets over, in the body they are given some kind of last rites. So, but if somebody is swallowed, then there is no chance of any last rites at all. And it's considered to be a very gruesome death, both from the physical point of view of the body being destroyed, and also from the point of view of the body doesn't get any last rites. That's why when Lord Ram goes to the forest, and then he comes in the middle of India to a place called Ramtek, and there he sees a huge mound of bones which are there. And these are the bones of, these are the all the sages that the Rakshasas, the man-eating demons, the cannibals have eaten. And after eating all those, they can't eat the bones. So in order to create terror in the people around nearby, and to make a parade of how many sages they have killed, they have piled all the bones together like a victory piling, a trophy. And when Ram sees that, he's furious. And he says, I take a vow here that I will rid the world of these demoniac upstarts, disruptors, cannibals, and that's what he does eventually. So the point I'm making here is, to be devoured where the body also is not available for any remains is itself a very scary, very grisly prospect. And Aghasur plans to do this to Krishna and his associates, whoever might be there. And as he comes in, as Krishna and his associates are coming to the forest, they look at this. What is this? Children are naturally curious. Whenever they come to a new place, what is that? What is that? If there are parents or elders who are ready to answer their questions, curious children can have endless questions. What is this? What is this? What is this? So now, of course, the children are themselves together. So they see something and what is that? Let's see that. Let's see that. And then, as they're looking around, they suddenly see this huge python. And Aghasura is lying down there motionless. So he's lying down motionless because he wants to not alarm or alert the cowherd boys who are coming. So he just lies there motionless, and then the Rajwasi children, they start thinking, what is happening? So is this real? If it's a real snake demon, it's scary. But if it is not, then is it some kind of magical play? Some item, children like to play in some various ways. Sometimes we go to amusement parks or even normal parks that are there. There are slides. There are places that people can climb up. And sometimes some slides or some kind of toy items are fashioned in a way that they are suitable for children. So I was at a park in Australia, and there I saw that, I was just going for a program, they saw that actually they had shaped their swings, their slides, and various, like various animals. So they had this, you climb up onto go up a stairs, and you climb down, and it's like there's a closed passage through which the kids go down, but it was shaped like a python. So from up you go inside and you slide down and go round, and then you come out of its tail. So kids like to have some kind of exciting sports, playful things to do, and kids like to play with animals also. So both of them can be combined in this way. So the Raja Gopas thought that is this some fun thing? Is this some toy? Is something which you can play with? And as they were asking Krishna, they were so young and playful and impetuous that they didn't even think, what is it really? They asked Krishna, and before Krishna could answer, they said, let's explore. And he started walking inside. When they walked inside, at that time Krishna was observing and Krishna was thinking. Krishna, when he saw this, immediately became suspicious. And then he recognized this is a demon. But his Gopa friends were so playful and so we could say restless, that play and rest are opposite. So they were playful and restless. They just couldn't stay in one place. So they just went inside. And before Krishna could stop them, they were inside. And now Krishna was thinking what to do. So he also decided to go inside. And as he entered into this demon's mouth, now the kids are thinking, okay, this is just something to play with. And that's how they were entering. Otherwise, they would not enter into a demon's mouth like this. But as soon as they entered, Aghasura was waiting for this opportunity itself. And he had been completely motionless till then. But then, he closed his mouth. And suddenly, Krishna and the Vrajivas and the Vrajagopas found themselves trapped inside this fearsome demon, not knowing what to do, how to move on now. And as they were thinking like this, the toxic substances in his stomach were so great that nobody could survive over there. And from above, Krishna's pastimes are often watched by the demons, by the devatas, because the devatas are concerned that Krishna should be able to kill the demons. And therefore, what they do is that they often do the necessary that is required for, you could say, cheering Krishna on. So now Aghasura is such a fearsome demon. Normally, you know, if there are two people who are fighting, if it's a sports match, you can cheer on whichever party you want. But if it's a real fight between, say, two gangsters, they're fighting, then people are afraid to cheer anyone. Because if one gangster wins and we have been cheering the opposite person, then this gangster may get on our case. How dare you cheer my opponent? So the devatas in this case were not cheering Aghasura, cheering Krishna. They're watching from above. They thought Aghasura is a very scary demon. They're just watching without speaking anything. But as soon as Krishna entered into that demon's mouth, at that time, they started becoming fearful. And they started lamenting, oh, what has happened? Krishna has died. They said, to enter into someone's mouth is to enter into death. So, now when Krishna goes inside, Krishna is still unaffected. There are several cases in the Lord's past, in the scriptures, where somebody enters into someone's mouth, it's like you have gone into the jaws of death. It's sometimes in sports matches, it says that it's a very close match. So victory was snatched from the jaws of defeat. That means, if you go into somebody's jaws, it's almost that you are going to be killed, but somehow you come out of the jaws. But in the scriptures, it's not only you go into the jaws, from the jaws you go into even the belly. Still you come out. So this happens on several occasions. Vritrasur swallows Indra, but then Indra kills Vritrasur from within. Similarly, when Hanuman is flying across the ocean, at that time a demoness Simhika swallows him. And then he comes out from her belly. So it said that we should not think that we are victorious till we are actually victorious. So don't count your, as they say in a poultry business, that don't count your eggs till the hens have hatched. Don't count your chicken till the eggs have hatched or whatever. So don't count your victory too much in advance. So Aghasura thought, yes, my mission is successful. But Krishna had his own plan. Krishna from inside the mouth, he went inside the belly of Aghasura, and from there he just ripped open Aghasura's belly. And Aghasura, who had thought that, suddenly, one moment he felt a wrenching, unbearable pain in his abdomen as Krishna started hitting it from within. And before he could comprehend anything, he just was dead. If somebody attacks us from outside, we can at least fight them. But if somebody is inside us and they attack from inside, what can we do practically? We have no defense resources at all. So in general, Krishna in Vrindavan doesn't use any weapons. And Krishna in Vrindavan doesn't even have to fight much. There is action, but there is no sustained action. It's not that enemy attacks and Krishna dodges and then Krishna attacks back and the enemy dodges. No, it is Krishna playfully. Bala krida kamiva. Uddhava, while remembering Krishna's pastimes, in the third canto says that Krishna kills the demons like a bala krida kamiva. Just as a child may play with toys. And so similarly, Krishna just effortlessly kills Aghasura. And when Aghasura, his belly is opened wide and he is dead, then the demigods start cheering from above. They start showering flowers, celebrating Krishna's extraordinary victory. That Krishna has not only come out of the jaws of death, Krishna has come out of the belly of death, you could say. So, such is the extraordinary potency of Krishna. Krishna Bhagavan ki jai. So now, Bhaktivinoda Thakur describes that different demons represent different things. So, he talks about this both in Chaitanya Shikshamrit as well as in Krishna Samhita. Chaitanya Shikshamrita is like one of his classic books, and Krishna Samhita is also one of his books. So there he describes that Aghasura represents cruelty and violence. So if I'll talk about this for a few minutes, that violence is just a fact of life. If sometimes when we live in cities and there are so many noises and there is so much pollution, we may feel that, oh, I would like to live in a scenic forest area. Of course, here it's beautiful. You have greenery all around. But if we were, I would be serene living in a remote forest. But actually, forest life is not all that pleasant. In the jungle, if we go, as you say, the law of the jungle, Darwin did get some part right. He talked about survival of the fittest. So yes, that's true. Anybody who's unfit will be killed. Of course, Prabhupada had a refutation to that also. Prabhupada said they talk about survival of the fittest, but the fact is even the fittest don't survive. Nobody survives ultimately. Just the fittest survive longer than the unfit. But the point is, forest life, jungle life is very cruel. The law of the jungle is might is right. And everybody is sooner or later killed. Everybody dies. So dharma, when the Mahabharata as well as the Hitopadesha, dharma is what differentiates human from animals. Ahara nidra bhayamaitunam cha samanyam etat pashubhir naranam dharmo hi tesham adhiko vishesho dharmena hina pashubhi samanha. So without dharma, humans are like animals. Dharma doesn't refer to necessarily, say, some religious practices, say that doing some puja of some deities or doing some prayers to God. Dharma essentially refers to that philosophical quest which inspires humans to curb their animal nature. There is animal nature within everyone, but that nature is curbed by social regulation and by spiritual revelation. Social regulation refers to the government rule that is there. If sometimes there are disasters, there are hurricanes or there are earthquakes, sometimes such abnormal situations, they can bring out the best within people or they can bring out the beast within people. So bring out the best means sometimes people help anyone and everyone. You know, you are homeless, come and stay in my place. I'll offer you this. Sometimes there are extraordinary acts of humanitarian compassion and courage that are seen in disaster-prone areas. But sometimes there are acts of barbaric violence and despotism that are also seen. When people are already afflicted, they're homeless, their homes are ruined, and they're just going with some possessions, some thugs may come and they just plunder everything, strip people of everything. So that is horrendous. So the point which I am making here is that cruelty and violence are just facts of material existence. But in some people or in some situations, the cruelty and violence become far, far more than others. And when this happens, it can cause great suffering to people. So everybody has anger. But just an angry person is not considered to be cruel or violent. All of us, we have within us, based on our upbringing or based on our culture, there are certain boundaries which we will not cross. We all get angry. But when we get angry, some of us may just yell at someone. Some of us may just decide not to talk with anyone. Just give the other person the silent treatment. Some of us may just go away from somewhere for some time just to process that anger. Some people might just take a boxing bag and beat the boxing bag. But some people, when they get angry, they might become physically abused. They might take things, take things and throw at the other person. They might take a gun and shoot other people. So when this anger is a normal human emotion, but when the expression of anger goes beyond civilized boundaries, then that person becomes dangerous. So demons are not just beings with some peculiar forms. A demon doesn't have to have a horn on their head or teeth coming off their mouths to be demons. Demons are basically souls like us, but souls whose lower nature has no civilized boundaries to it. So Aghasura represents that aspect within us of cruelty and violence, that even a person who is normally, who would want to kill a child? To kill anyone is brutal, it's ghastly. But to kill a child is unspeakably ghastly. To kill a number of children, a series of children together, it's outrageously brutal. So when Aghasura came, he wanted to just kill so many people. Now we may say that we don't have that kind of cruelty or violence. That is true. You know, those who are practicing bhakti, the anger's expression may not be to that extent. But we can also be cruel and violent in our own ways. How can that be? It is usually, if we consider cruelty and violence, it is in our relationship with others. There can be verbal violence. There can be verbal cruelty. When we are practicing bhakti and we are sharing bhakti, it's very important that we represent Krishna properly. I was talking with a prominent preacher in our movement, and he was telling me his realization that we often think of taking credit. So many people became devotees. I preached and this person became a devotee. I preached and this person became a devotee. And this person became a devotee. He says, but how often do we count, because of me, how many people did not become devotees? You know, because of the way I spoke, because of the way I conducted myself, because of the way I may have become too argumentative, too egoistic. Sometimes if some people have different opinions, then we may come down too heavily on them. You know, we may become insensitive. And so many people we may alienate from us, from Krishna, not just from us, from Krishna. So, for us to represent the glorious Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition, the glorious Bhakti tradition, which Srila Prabhupada has given to us, it's a great responsibility. And if we don't present Krishna consciousness properly, many, many people may go away. Anudvega karam vakyam satyam priyahitam chayat swadhyaya abhyasanam chayiva vanmayam tapa uchyate. Krishna in 17.15, the Bhagavad Gita says that austerity of speech means to speak in a way that is non-agitating, that is truthful, that is pleasing, that is beneficial, and that follows scriptural guidelines. So for us, there is Aghasura within us, and that Aghasura within us may impel us towards violence and cruelty. So that violence and cruelty may come out where somebody is coming from some conception, and we are trying to give them some higher understanding. But if they don't agree, we just trample over them. And the result of that is that they just get alienated. Now, Prabhupada was expert in dealing with different people in different occasions. And Prabhupada said that if, especially, I'll conclude with one point about verbal violence and how to avoid it, that sometimes we feel strongly tempted to put people in their place. How dare you speak like this? How dare you say like this? Put people in their place. It said, instead of putting people in their place, put yourself in their place. That means think from their perspective. Try to understand what they are thinking, understand what they are feeling, and then respond. See, whenever people, so for example, in today's world, people may be following some other spiritual teacher of maybe of dubious credentials, and they may have some strange philosophies or whatever, and they feel this is absurd. Why do you believe such stuff? And we may feel that I'm helping them to rise to a higher level. It's true, we are meant to rise to a higher level, help them to rise to a higher level. But you know, for them, that might be just one shred of truth that they have. Suppose like it's cold now, not very cold, but suppose it's very cold, and then somebody has got just a torn cloth to wear. The torn cloth doesn't really protect them from the cold. But if we try to rip off that torn cloth, our intention might be If you want to, I'll give you a warm cloth, a good warm dress to wear, and you'll be better off. But if that is the only dress they have, that is the only thing protecting them from cold, they will fight to their life to not give it up. So first, we have to give them the new cloth. Okay, you wear this. And when they wear it, oh, it comforts them, it protects them. Then they will themselves drop the earlier cloth. Because this isn't really fit. This isn't really protecting me. But if first we make them give up that earlier cloth, they will be so fearful that they will not give it up. So similarly, people have some experience, some logic, something they have got by which they have got some understanding of things. And if you tell them to give up that understanding first, it's like telling them to give up the cloth. Although that cloth may not be protecting them properly, but still that is all they have. So what we need to do is present Krishna consciousness in a way that they become ready to accept it. And in accepting Krishna consciousness, something has to be rejected, no doubt. But the rejection doesn't have to come first. The acceptance can come first. Instead of telling people how what they believe is wrong, you can tell them how Krishna consciousness makes sense. If we do that, if we follow that approach, just explain how Krishna consciousness makes sense. And if they have certain beliefs, we can, without being critical of them or critical of their teachers, whoever it be, because people, when they themselves are attacked, they become defensive. And if some people whom they consider to be sacred, they are attacked, they become ultra defensive, they become aggressive also. And the ego is such a thing, once the ego goes into defensive, even a nuclear bomb cannot lodge it. So once people go into defensive, then we can never enter their hearts, we cannot enter their heads also. So therefore, wherever they are at, we try to connect Krishna with them, help present Krishna in such a way that it makes sense to them. And as it starts making sense, then, this makes sense. Then they will accept it. And thus, we'll be able to bring Krishna into their hearts. Into their hearts. And thus they will get the fruit of Krishna Bhakti blossoming in their hearts and enriching their lives in due course. So I'll summarize. I spoke today about the demon Aghasura. And I started by talking about how some demons came inside Krishna's house, but Aghasura is the demon who came outside. And children are actually curious, so when they saw this demon, they thought it's a plaything. And to be killed is bad enough, to be devoured so that there's no body left, it's especially brutal. And Aghasura came in that form, wanting to finish off Krishna. So he was motionless because he wanted to conceal his malevolent intention and catch the children off guard. And when he devoured Krishna, he thought, I've already won. But Krishna was inside, and Krishna from inside did an inside out job and finished him off. So Aghasura represents cruelty and violence. Anger is there within all of us, but in demoniac people, the anger goes beyond civilized bounds, and thus they can act in horrendous ways when they become angry. So in the animal world, there is a might is right, which is the rule. In the human world, dharma is social regulation and a spiritual revelation, which keeps people under control. But when dharma is rejected, as the demons do, then social order crumbles. So all of us, we may also succumb to cruelty and violence when we insensitively try to thrust our philosophy down people's throats. So instead of ripping off whatever cloth they have from their bodies, we give them the cloth of Krishna Bhakti. And that means instead of forcing them to reject what they believe, just explain to them how what we practice makes sense. And as they accept it, gradually their misconceptions will go away. So thank you very much. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupad ki, Gaur Bhaktarind ki, Tai Gaur Premanand.